I will exalt in his name. adore you, Lord, we declare,
nobody like you.
We worship,
adore you.
In the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We know there is nobody like you. There is none like you. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. We bless you, Lord. We magnify you, Lord. Ooh, how great is thy faithfulness. Hallelujah. How excellent is thy name, O Lord. How excellent is thy name. For at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that you are Lord. You are Lord of lords. You are a mighty God. You are a Prince of Peace. You are our everlasting Father. And we bless you. If we had 1,000 tongues, we couldn't praise you enough. Hallelujah to the King of Kings. Hallelujah to the Lord of Lords. We bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you because this is the day that you have made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. What a mighty day it is. What a great God we serve. Hallelujah to the Lamb, the sacrificial Lamb of God. We bless you, Lord, as we invoke your presence in this service. Lord, we ask you to have your way. We ask you to move by your spirit. We can't praise you, God. Hallelujah. Unless you move mightily in this service, Lord. We can't magnify you unless you move mightily, Lord. We need you to move, Lord. We need you to deliver, Lord. We need you to set free, Lord. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, God. We need you to do something great. We need you to do something marvelous. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Bless our bishop as he comes forth with the word of God. We thank you for your word, Lord. For in your word there is life, and life more abundantly. There is eternal life, and we praise you. Hallelujah. Now have your way. Have your way. Have your way. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for healing, Lord. Hallelujah. Somebody got diabetes, heal in the name of Jesus. Somebody got high blood pressure, heal in the name of Jesus. Somebody doesn't have peace, peace be still in the name of Jesus. Peace like a river, peace be still. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our great deliverer. For your excellent greatness, and we give you praise, Lord. We give you honor. Now, right where you are, come on and say, thank you, Jesus. Come on, let me. hear you say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And it's okay to clap your hands. It's okay to rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God bless you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, don't let the praise drop. Keep the praise going. Somebody say hallelujah. Tell them thank you. Hallelujah. 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 Praise team. Song that said, there's nobody like you. Nobody like you. Nobody like you. Nobody like unto the Lord our God. Hallelujah. That's the kind of God that we serve. There is nobody like the Lord our God. Hallelujah. We give him the praise. We give him the glory, and we give him all of the honor. Yes, he is. He's worthy. Worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. He is worthy. Ah. I just know even on this week, he did something for you that was worthy of your praise. This week, if you think back on this week, the Lord did something that was worthy of your praise. So give him that praise right now. Give him that praise. Give him that praise right now. Right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Give him that praise. Oh, God. Ah. Somebody got a breakthrough this week. Somebody got a breakthrough this past week. You better praise him. Somebody got a breakthrough this past week. And if you are that somebody, you better give a praise right now. Right where you are. Praise him. Right where you are. Yeah. Woo, God. Praise him. Hallelujah. Somebody got a breakthrough. Somebody got an answer. Somebody got their deliverance. Somebody got an open door this past week. And this is the day that the Lord has made. And you ought to give God some praise on the day for what he has even done on this past week for you. You know it had to be nobody but the Lord. You know that if it had not been for the Lord who was on your side, yeah, yeah, yeah. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, hi. Yeah, y'all better go ahead and praise him. Y'all better go ahead and praise him. This is a praise break. A praise break. A praise break. Give him praise. Give him praise. Give him glory. Give him honor. Hallelujah. Woo. and praise him. Take a moment. If you sit down, get up right now and begin to give God some praise. If you're sitting down, get up right now. If you're laying down, get up right now and give God some praise. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Oh God, yes God, yes Lord, yes Lord, yes Lord, yes Lord, hallelujah, saints used to sing a song, he's a wonder in my soul, he's a wonder in my soul, he's a wonder in my soul. Bless his name. He's a wonder in my soul. He's a wonder in my soul. He's a wonder in my soul. Bless his name. Hallelujah. My Lord. Yes. Woo, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Bless his name. Bless his name. Bless his name. Truly, God is worthy of the praise. When you just take a moment to think on the goodness of the Lord Jesus Christ and what he has done for you, that ought to cause your soul to cry out, hallelujah. Thank God for saving me. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus, for yet another opportunity to lift up our voices to give you praise, to give adoration unto you, to let you know once again just how much we love you and how much you mean to us, how much we love and appreciate all that you are for us in our lives. There is nobody like unto our God. Hallelujah. And we praise our God because he is just that worthy, just so good to us. And we give him the glory and the honor. Even right now, we just open up our mouths and we begin to give God the fruit of our lips, blessing him, loving on him, telling him how great he is, telling him how awesome he is, telling him how worthy he is of all of our praise. Hallelujah. Yes, yes, yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, my brothers and my sisters, it is once again our privilege and pleasure to come into your places of abode, for you to join in with us as we praise and we worship God together in the beauty of holiness. We praise God for each and every one of you who has tuned in to this Gospel Tabernacle TV broadcast. We thank God for you, all of our brothers and our sisters in Christ, those who have tuned in to partake in this worship service experience. We love you. We thank God for you. And we're praying God's choice blessings to be upon you and your family during this time, during this season that we're in right now. God is still in control. God is still on the throne. God is still yet getting the glory out of all that's going on right now. We praise him for keeping us safe, keeping us secure, keeping us protected. And we even praise him during a time like this. We praise him for his healing power, because we know that God is still a healer. The Bible tells us that with the stripes of Jesus, we are healed. Amen. And the power of God can heal any and everything, even heal from COVID-19. And so we praise God for his healing power. Hallelujah. Yes, we're going to do all the things that the CDC recommends as far as wearing masks and social distancing and washing our hands and doing all those things. But at the end of the day, after we do all of that, we still need the healing power of Jesus Christ to cover us and to cover our families. And so we're going to be prayerful and mindful of all that we have to do. But our ultimate trust and our hope is in the Lord our God. God bless you to all of the members and friends of Gospel Tabernacle Church. We praise God for you, for God keeping us connected, keeping us even in fellowship during this time when we can't come together to corporately worship, amen, in the house of the Lord. But we thank God for you right where you are. And we praise God because God is omnipresent. That means he's everywhere at the same time. So while he's here in the sanctuary of Gospel Tabernacle Church, he is also wherever you are right now watching this broadcast. He's in your homes. He's in your cars. He's wherever you might be watching this broadcast. And so we praise God because he is everywhere present at the same time. We want to encourage you, Gospel Tabernacle family, to continue in your sowing of your seeds, your tithes, your offerings, and your love gifts. We thank God for what you've been doing, and we praise God for how you have continuously sustained our great church during this season of pandemic. You know that there are several ways to give through Givelify, and you can mail in your tithes and your offerings to the church office, or you can stop by the church on Sunday afternoons between 12:30 and 1:30 in the afternoon. And we know that God will, and God is already supplying all of our needs according to his riches and glory as we take care of the house of God and kingdom business. God indeed takes care of us. I'm a witness that as I sow seed into good ground, that God provides for all of my needs, and he even gives me some wants on top of that. Hallelujah. That's the kind of good God that we serve. Amen. Our praise team is coming to take us further in worship, and then we will proceed to the Word of God.
Come on, say it again, in my life. Come on, say that again. In my life. Back to the top. In my life, Lord.
In my life.
Be lifted high.
Be lifted.
Be glorified.
Be glorified.
Sing it again. In my life.
In my life. Be glorified. Be glorified.
Say it again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
Lord, just one more time, I dare you to lift your hand and say it right here. Say, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Oh, just one more time, everybody say, in my life, be glorified, be glorified. Say it again.
In my life, be glorified, be glorified.
Come on, let somebody give them worship right here.
My life, God, you be glorified. You get the glory, you get the praise out of my life in all that I say and do. Lord, I want you to get the glory. I want to draw your attention to the 29th chapter of the book of Genesis. We've been in Genesis for the last 3 or so weeks, and we want to stay right here in the book of beginnings, Genesis chapter number 29, and we want to draw your attention starting at verse number 15, and we want to read through verse number 28. Genesis chapter 29, verses 15 through 28. It reads like this. And Laban said unto Jacob, because thou art my brother, shouldest thou therefore serve me for naught? Tell me, what shall thy wages be? And Laban had 2 daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah was tender-eyed, but Rachel was beautiful and well-favored. And Jacob loved Rachel and said, I will serve thee 7 years for Rachel, thy younger daughter. And Laban said, it is better that I give her to thee than that I should give her to another man. Abide with me. And Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed unto him but a few days for the love he had to her. And Jacob said unto Laban, give me my wife, for my days are fulfilled, that I may go in unto her. And Laban gathered together all the men of the place and made a feast. And it came to pass at the evening that he took Leah, his daughter, and brought her to him. And he went in unto her. And Laban gave unto his daughter Leah Zilpah, his maid, for an handmaid. And it came to pass that in the morning, behold, it was Leah. And he said to Laban, what is this thou hast done unto me? Did not I serve with thee for Rachel? Wherefore then hast thou beguiled me? And Laban said, it must not be so done in our country, to give the younger before the firstborn. Fulfill her week, and we will give thee this also for the service which thou shalt serve with me yet 7 other years. And Jacob did so and fulfilled her week, and he gave him Rachel, his daughter, to wife also. I want to use for a subject from this passage of scripture, from disappointment to delight. From disappointment to delight. Would you pray with me? Father, it is in the name of Jesus that once again we come to you with this awesome privilege of approaching your most holy throne of grace. Father, we can do nothing without you. We need you in all that we do and say. Empower us and strengthen us right now for the task that is before us. Holy Spirit, speak through this vessel of clay that your people may hear your voice and not my voice. Have your way in this place today, that God, every listener, may hear you speak to them clearly and concisely. Bless us now, God, as we open up the rich treasures of your word. Make your word come alive to us. Make it come alive that we might see it for ourselves. In Jesus' name, we thank you in advance for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, we thank you and we pray and we say together, amen and amen. From disappointment to delight. As we learned on last week, my brothers and my sisters, we learned that Brother Jacob was not a good guy. He had some major flaws and some major issues. Brother Jacob, he was a man of no integrity. He was a man without moral character. He was a man who had a loose relationship with the truth. In other words, he was a liar. He was a man that would not be someone you would hold up to your young children to emulate. He was just not a good guy at all. Matter of fact, his name, Jacob, means supplanter. It means trickster. It means con artist. It means one who is underhanded and does dirty stuff. But even despite all of that background, God, for his own sovereign reason, chose to use Brother Jacob for his glory and for his honor. And so God once again proves to us that your history cannot cancel your destiny in God. What you have been or who you were does not cancel what God wants for you in his future that he has planned for you. Jacob was an interesting character. We know from the previous chapters in the book of Genesis how Jacob tricked his brother Esau, his twin brother Esau, out of his rightful birthright during a time when Esau was at a very vulnerable moment in his life. And Jacob came in and tricked him out of his birthright. And then we find out a few years later that Jacob takes his old, his feeble, his blind, his failing, and his dying father Isaac with the help of his mother Rebekah, and they trick Isaac into giving Jacob his last blessing before he closed his eyes for good in death. And so in that, Jacob was exiled from his father's house. He had to run for his life because he understood that Esau, his brother, made a vow. And Esau said, if I catch him, I'm going to kill him when our father closes his eyes for the last time. And so Jacob had to run for his life. His father, Isaac, sent him off to get a wife. And he made Jacob promise that he would not get a wife from the daughters of the land of Canaan, but he sent him to his mother's father's house of Bethuel, sent him there to get a wife of his uncle, his mother's brother Laban, one of his daughters, sent him there to get a wife for himself. Now, there are some interesting family dynamics here. Let's just look at them for a moment. Rebecca is Jacob's mother, right? And so Rebecca and her brother Laban are actually the grandchildren of Nahor, who is the brother of Abraham, which means that Rebecca and Laban are also the great niece and nephew of Abraham, which also means that Isaac, Jacob's father, married his cousin Bethuel's daughter, Rachel, right? So now, here we have this story. We know that Jacob is a trickster. He's a con man. He's a con artist. But Laban is an old school con artist. Laban is an old school con man. And I believe that on Jacob's journey of transformation from where he is to where God wants him to be, Laban plays an intricate part in the transformation of Jacob. Laban is an old school con man, an old school trickster and supplanter. So Isaac sends Jacob to Laban's house. When he gets to the land of Laban, the Bible says that Jacob asked some men there, "Does anybody know of somebody by the name of Laban?" They said, "Yeah, we know Laban. As a matter of fact, here comes his daughter Rachel tending to his flock right now." And you've got to understand that the moment that Jacob laid eyes on Rachel, he was smitten, he was done, he was enthralled with her beauty, he was captured by what he saw. And so he goes to Rachel and he tells Rachel, he says, I'm the son of your father's sister, Rebecca. And then she goes back to her father Laban and says, "Your nephew, your sister Rebecca's son, is here." Laban goes out to greet Jacob. Laban hugs him and Laban kisses him. Laban says, "You are of my bone and you are of my flesh. You are my family. Come and stay with us." Jacob stayed with Laban for about a month. And then after the month was gone, month was over, Laban says to Jacob, he says, "You are my family. I can't have you here working for me for nothing. What is it that you want me to pay you for your services?" Now, Laban had two daughters. He had the oldest one, who was Leah, and then he had Rachel, who was the youngest one. They say that I'm gonna read it for you right here, because it gives a special description of who Leah was. And I want to say it just right. Here it is. All right. Here we go. It says that the elder was Leah, and Rachel was the younger one, but I want to get to the description of her. Wouldn't you not know I can't find it when I want to see it? Yes, here it is. The Bible says that Leah was tender-eyed. That's a nice way of saying that she was not pretty to look at all. But then it says that Rachel was beautiful and she was well-favored. Jacob said this to Laban. Jacob says, I'll work for you for 7 years if you give me your youngest daughter Rachel's hand in marriage. Laban says, I should give her to you as opposed to somebody else. And he says, we have a deal. So then Jacob works for 7 long years for Rachel's hand in marriage. And the Bible says to Jacob, it was just like a few short days because he loved Rachel so much. Well, Jacob had worked his 7 years and he goes back to Laban and he says, Laban, I have served my time. Now give me your daughter Rachel's hand in marriage. Well, it was the custom of the people then when there was a wedding that there would be a week-long wedding celebration. So Laban called together all the people and all the men, all the fixings and all the trimmings, and brought them together, and they had this feast. Well, the Bible says nighttime had come and the sun had gone down. And so it was now that Laban goes and gets his eldest daughter, Leah, and brings Leah to Jacob's chamber under the cover of night. No doubt, I'm sure that Laban made sure that he got Jacob nice and drunk as well so he wouldn't realize what he was about to do to him. So Laban brings Leah into Jacob's chambers, and Jacob lays with Leah, not knowing who she was. They consummate this marriage contract. The morning comes, the sun comes up, and Jacob turns over expecting he's going to see the beautiful face of the love of his life, Rachel. But instead, he turns over and he looks who's laying beside him and he sees that it is Leah and not Rachel. He has been hoodwinked. He has been bamboozled. He has been lied to. He has been tricked. He feels hurt. He feels taken advantage of. He feels like somebody has put a knife in his back and betrayed him. He is angry. He is upset because somebody has taken advantage of him in his moment of weakness. That sounds something like something that we saw from him that he did to some other folk just a little while ago. But now the foot of the tables have been turned on Jacob. Jacob gets up. Jacob goes to Laban and Jacob says, how could you do this to me? You know our agreement was that I would work for you for 7 years, of which I did. And the agreement was I would work for you for 7 years and then you would give me the hand of your daughter Rachel in marriage. How could you do this to me? How could you trick me? The Bible says, how could you beguile me like this, Laban? And Laban says, it is not our custom to marry off the younger before we marry off the firstborn. And so I gave you Leah. He says, but I tell you what I'm going to do. You just work out for this last part of this week of celebration. And after we finish out this week of celebration with your marriage to Leah, he says, at the end of the week, then I will give you Rachel's hand in marriage. But here is the caveat. But you got to work for me 7 more years before you are free from your contract. He had been bamboozled, as I said. He had been tricked into working 14 years instead of 7 years for the one he really wanted. And so he worked for 7 more years in order to fulfill the contract. So it is ironic, my brothers and my sisters, that God turned the tables on Jacob. But I just believe that this was a part of his transformation process, because sometimes you have to go through some things and have the spotlight turned on you so the mirror could shine on you so you could see what you are just for who you are. It was really poetic justice of that Laban had done to him just what he had done to his own brother Esau and to his own father Isaac. But I just believe that sometimes we don't realize how low down and how bad we are and how guilty we are until we see just who we are in the light of somebody else. And so God, I believe, used his uncle Laban to turn the tables on Jacob to help him see himself for who he really was. A lot of times we don't want to confess that we're wrong or that we're guilty because we can't see it. But when somebody does the same thing to us that we've done to somebody else, we have to admit and confess, God, I'm guilty. God, it was me all the time. I'm the wrong one. And so they turned the tables on Brother Jacob, and he had done to him just what he did to somebody else. Ah, but God still had a plan for Brother Jacob's life. God was still working things out in Brother Jacob's life. And I just believe that this was the beginning of the turning point in Brother Jacob's life. But I know from reading the Word of God that God does indeed get the glory out of Brother Jacob's life. This was just the first turning point in his life. But as we read along the story, if we look at the movie of Jacob's life and we fast forward a few chapters ahead, we will come to this scene where Brother Jacob wrestles all night long with this angelic being. And then when he wrestles all night long, this angelic being tells him, you have contended with God and you have contended with man and you have prevailed. In other words, you have held on, you have fought the good fight, you have gone through some things with God and you've gone through some things with mankind, and you did not quit. You did not give up. You did not throw in the towel. And now, because you held on and you did not turn back and you went through everything you had to go through, you suffered and you endured the hardship and the heartache and the pain and the disappointment, and you still held on, the angelic being says from God that because you held on and you did not quit, he says, now you are a prince with God and a prince with man. In other words, in the end, Jacob's journey would be complete, and Jacob's disappointment would go from disappointment all the way to delight. Why? Because when God is in the middle of your story, God knows how to make everything turn out for your good. He works stuff out through the counsel of his own will, and he makes things work out for your good. And I'm so glad that the God we serve knows how to take our messed up, knows how to take our jacked up, knows how to take our screwed up life, knows how to take all of our mess and turn it around for his good. You have to know, my brothers and my sisters, after all you did and after all you've been through, the fact that you are still alive, the fact that you are still breathing, it means that God is not through with you yet. It means that God is still working on you and that God is going to get the glory out of your life. You ought to give God praise right there. You ought to thank God right there that he didn't leave you in your Jacob season. You ought to thank God that God didn't leave you in your Jacob mess. You ought to thank God that even through your times of a heartache and disappointment, that God didn't leave you there, but he worked with you long enough for you to get through your Jacob stage until it was time for him to change your name, good God, from Zion. Because what happens here is that in the end, God changes his name from Jacob to Israel. God says to him, how do you define yourself? He says, I call myself Jacob. I call myself a con man, a trickster, a supplanter. But God says, henceforth from now on, you shall no longer be called Jacob, but you shall be called Israel, because you are a prince with God and man. And I just come to let somebody know today that God is working on your new name. God is working on your new name. You're not what you used to be, thank God. But even better than that, you're not what you're going to be. And you ought to give God praise, because God is working on you. You had some disappointments in your life. You had some disappointing days. You had some disappointing seasons in your life. But I come to let you know that God is turning your season of disappointment into delight. That's right. I come to let you know that while you may be going through the valley right now, God is working on your disappointment, and he's going to transform you and then transform your disappointment into his delight. You ought to give God praise, because he does not leave you as Jacob, but he works with you as Jacob. He coddles you as Jacob. He's long-suffering with you as Jacob. But when the time comes, God's going to say, you passed the test. You met all the criteria. And henceforth from now on, you will no longer be called Jacob. I'm changing you. I'm transforming you from Jacob to Israel. And I come to let you know, your name may be Jacob right now, but God's got a new name for you. God is working on your destiny. God is working on your destiny. God is working on your destiny. Don't worry about what it looks like right now. God is working on your destiny. So thank God. Thank God, because your day of name change, of being changed from Jacob to Israel, is on the way. And God's going to make everything turn out for your good. He won't leave you in your Jacob season, but he'll walk with you. He'll work with you. He'll hold you. He'll keep you. He'll coddle you. He'll cover you. He'll protect you all the way until you get to the day when he will say, henceforth, from this day on, don't call yourself Jacob no more, but call yourself Israel. Don't call yourself a trickster, a con man, a supplanter. Those days are your history, but I'm working on your destiny. Yes, you did it back then, but I've got something great and grand and glorious for you right now. No longer will you identify as Jacob, but now you are Israel. From disappointment to delight, from disappointment to delight, I'm on my way to victory. I'm on my way to deliverance. I'm on my way to breakthrough. I'm on my way to open doors. I'm on my way to miracles. I'm on my way to happiness. I'm on my way to joy. I'm on my way to peace. I'm on my way to fulfillment. I'm on my way to the promises of God. From disappointment to delight, that's it, I'm through. Give them praise for your delight. Give them glory for your delight. Give them glory for your breakthrough. Give them glory for your open door. Give them glory for your miracle. Say yeah, say yeah. From disappointment to delight. Come on, put your hands together. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm on my way. Hey. From disappointment to delight. That's why I believe that the story of Jacob is so important for us to connect with. Because as we look at Jacob's life, at his journey, we see that God can take us from a place of dishonor to a place of honor. He can take us from a place of disappointment to a place of delight. That's what God wants for you, my brother. That's what God wants for you, my sister. He wants to take you from a place of dishonor to a place of honor. From a place of disappointment to a place of delight. And if there's anybody that could do that, it surely is the God of the universe, our Savior, our God, and our King. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we come to you today, lifting up your precious, most holy name. We thank you, God, because you took us in our state of dishonor, disarray, our state that was far from you. But you had a plan for our lives, and you watched over us. You protected us, and you guided us. And so, God, we thank you that you did not cut us off when we were Jacob, but you were long-suffering with us. You were faithful to us, even when we weren't faithful to you. And we thank you, God, because you kept us and you preserved us long enough to get us to the place where we would be transformed from Jacob to Israel. Only you can do something as great as that. And so we thank you right now. God, we pray for every man, every woman, every boy, every girl who is under the sound of my voice right now. God, we pray that if they do not know you as their Lord and Savior, God, we pray that your Holy Spirit would convict them even right now in their heart. Compel them to draw nigh unto you. Compel them, oh God, to submit and surrender their lives to you. Oh God, if they're not saved, save them right now, God. Deliver them right now from the clutches of sin. Do it for your glory, God. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray even now. And we say together, amen and amen. My brothers and my sisters, you've heard this word today. And we thank God because you are on a journey from where you are to where God wants you to be. I encourage you, I compel you, if you're not saved, to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior. Let him change you. Let him transform you from who you are to what God wants you to be. He'll come into your heart. He'll totally transform your life. Give you a brand new life and a brand new start. Let him in today. He'll come in to stay. Open up your heart and let the Lord come in today. We love you. We praise God for you. We thank God for your continued support and your prayers. May God continue to richly bless you and your family. Until we meet again, we look forward to seeing you next week on Gospel Tabernacle TV. God bless you. That is